Hey, Dr. C here with you. Let's talk about finding the right balance of iodine during pregnancy. So this is a big deal. You know, health is important at any time in life, and we know that nutrients are a big part of health, but it's all amplified by a lot when we're thinking about a baby and a baby's health. So yeah, very, very critical topic. And some nutrients we know are ones that pregnant women may get in the wrong amounts. We know that pregnant needs are different than non-pregnant needs. And there has been some attention paid to the relevance of iodine, and there should be. We need good amounts for a healthy baby. So if you're pregnant or soon to become pregnant, how much iodine is best for you? You know, what amounts are important? What would that look like in terms of your diet? Iodized salt? Do you want to take iodine in supplements? Should you have a prenatal that has iodine? These are all super important questions, and they play into your health during pregnancy, your thyroid function during pregnancy, and also your baby's health and thyroid function during pregnancy and afterward. So super important stuff to get right. For starters, let's dive on into why this matters. Well, iodine is an essential mineral for thyroid function. Your thyroid makes hormones that control your ability to reproduce, to have a healthy metabolism, to repair hair, skin, and nails, to let your nerve cells and your brain work and communicate with one another. Yeah, it's critical for all kinds of things. And without iodine, that can't happen. Now, the paradox here is that iodine requirements are in a narrow window. And for some women who are prone to thyroid disease, that window is even narrower. And the other big wrinkle is that some are on thyroid medications, and that can change things further. So the body needs it, but it needs exacting amounts. Another big paradox is that too much and too little can look exactly the same. We can see the same problems. So we want to get it right, and it's essential to do so. Now, why would you need different amounts during pregnancy? Well, the simplest reason why nutrient needs of any type can change during pregnancy are because you're eating for two. You know, you got what you need for your body, and you've got what you need for the baby's body to grow and develop. So quite straightforward. But it gets a little more involved than that. So during pregnancy, the first portion, the first pre-trimester, the first trimester, most of the second trimester, baby is coasting on mom's thyroid hormone. So in the uterus, the fetus is using thyroid hormone, but it's mom's thyroid hormone that's getting the job done. The infant is not making its own. And the difference there is that there's not a higher need for iodine apart from the changes to the mom's body weight. So mom's a little bit heavier, you know, 10, 20, 30 pounds, but not huge amounts. And so she only needs more relative to how her body is bigger. But things change somewhere in the second trimester, and they're totally changed by the third trimester. And what's going on there is that the fetus's thyroid gland is coming online, and it's now making its own thyroid hormone for itself. And in those cases, now we need some different amounts of iodine. And this is especially relevant for moms on thyroid hormone. For the first portions of pregnancy, the first and second trimester, if you're on thyroid hormone, there's not a need for additional iodine apart from that, because the baby is not using iodine. The baby is using your thyroid hormone. Now, it's important to note that your need for thyroid hormone can change. For most pregnant moms, what that means is they need a little bit more as pregnancy goes on. The reasons for that are that the hormones that block thyroid are more prevalent. So the higher amounts of estrogen and progesterone cause your body to require more thyroid. There's also a thing called thyroid binding globulin, and that's also higher during pregnancy. And all of these make your body require a little more thyroid. Now, not every mom needs more, but many do, and it's not unusual. There are times too to where the immune system changes can cause you to need less. So it's important to stay on top of that. You never want to go more than a trimester without checking your thyroid. If it's fluctuating a lot, you may need to check it each month. But overall, as long as your thyroid is staying steady, baby and mom are going to have enough iodine for themselves when a mom is on medicine. Now, total amounts that we think about are different. And if someone's below a target, there's various complications that can emerge. Now, the most dramatic one is a thing called cretinism. And this is pretty intense. This is something that out of the gate, I want to say, doesn't really happen in the modern world, apart from some very rare, unusual exceptions, and none that have occurred in, I should say, don't occur at all today at present, but with some rare exceptions outside of the modern developed countries. So we've not had this in America for centuries, and it's really almost never showing up anywhere globally. But with cretinism, there's almost a total lack of thyroid stimulation on the developing baby. And this causes just massive inhibitions of normal brain development and also major skeletal changes. People who have cretinism, they look, actually some anthropologists found areas where cretinism was common and endemic and thought that they were groups of Neanderthals. They look like different species. They're quite distinct and they don't develop in the same ways. That's the most dramatic issue. Now, the next most dramatic issue that could happen with the wrong amount is a thing called congenital hypothyroidism. And that means the baby is born congenital with low thyroid function. So why does that happen? That can happen from iodine deficiency, but it can also happen from iodine excess. And in fact, the documented cases that have occurred in the recent past have been to mothers who were taking iodine supplements based on misguided advice. Congenital hypothyroidism, it can cause permanent birth delays and it can cause permanent cognitive decline. It can, you know, alter brain function for life. Some cases can require lifelong thyroid treatment and other health risks. And yeah, we've got published cases of moms who were given advice to take iodine supplements and they cause congenital hypothyroidism. Now, it could theoretically be caused by iodine deficiency as well. And here's the big paradox with iodine. There is data suggesting that if we look at some of the older guidelines and how much pregnant women need, based on those guidelines, some data points suggest that somewhere between 10 to 16% of moms may be lacking in iodine. But yet, when we look at populations and we look at these actual conditions, they're not showing up. So what's up if there's this chunk of people who are deficient, so to speak, but the problems aren't happening? Well, what's going on is how much we need is under revision. And new data points suggest that the minimal amounts necessary are probably a lot lower than we thought, that pregnant women don't need as much as we thought to stay stable. And correspondingly, the upper amounts that are tolerable are probably too high. And current guidelines suggest that women don't tolerate as much. Many women prone to thyroid disease don't tolerate even slight excesses. So some hard numbers on this. Older guidelines were suggesting adding 150 micrograms onto a woman's diet in the form of supplementation during pregnancy. And they suggested that moms should consume between about 150 and 300. And they said that moms were safe up to about 500 micrograms. Well, large data sets have shown that when moms get above 250 micrograms, there's higher rates of problems with thyroid function. So now 250 seems more like an upper limit. So what's a lower limit? Well, for moms not on thyroid medication, it seems like 100 micrograms is more of a lower limit. And for moms on thyroid medication, probably 50 micrograms is a more likely target for a lower limit. And what does that mean in terms of actual diet? Well, not a lot. You know, if your diet, we get iodine from a lot of sources. So there's some salt that's fortified with it. There's many kinds of salt that have naturally occurring iodine. We've got it in all types of seafood. Of course, sea vegetables have it. Dairy products have it. Grain products have it. Egg yolks have it. Animal proteins have it. Plant foods have it. So some foods have a lot, but no foods have none. So we always get some in a diet. Now, if a diet is only vegan and no iodized salt is used, no sea vegetables are used, there is a chance someone can get low. And that has happened. So since 1980, there have been 7 cases of people, not pregnant people, who were found to be iodine deficient. And they all had those criteria and they developed a goiter, which reversed on just consuming normal amounts. So yeah, on very strict, rare, unusual diets, one can get deficient. But typical diets, not a common problem. So what we do see, though, is that the further women get above 250 micrograms, the more likely they are to have thyroid problems during pregnancy, and the more likely the baby is as well. So these guidelines now are being adjusted downward. And how does this play out into daily intake? Well, we can talk about numbers, like you want this many micrograms, but you know, foods aren't labeled accurately. And you can find some food lists for some foods, but the amount in foods can vary tremendously. So it's simple, and also there's no easy ways to test individuals to see what their current intake is. So the most practical thing is just to think about certain dietary patterns. And in the thyroid reset diet, I broke foods down into three simple patterns. I called them green light, yellow light, and red light foods. So green light foods won't have a lot of iodine. They don't have none, but they probably won't have more than 10 micrograms per common serving. And the amounts they contain is rather consistent and predictable. That's important. So yellow light foods, they'll contain between about 10 to 50 micrograms, and that's pretty consistent as well. So you can kind of, you can bank on that. Red light foods, they can be all over the place. They might have a lot always. They might have a lot sometimes. But if there's a possible chance or probable chance they've got over 50 micrograms, I call those red light foods. If you're someone who has thyroid disease or is prone to it, you're better off avoiding those red light foods. Most of those are sea vegetables. Some of those are very dense in iodine types of seafood. Some of those are processed grains. And these are things you're better off really without as much as you can avoid them. So when someone is not pregnant and they're trying to help their thyroid work better, they focus their diet on the green light foods. And I call that the reset phase of the thyroid reset diet. When someone is pregnant, they want a little bit. They want a little bit of iodine. And if a woman is on thyroid medications, I suggest she consumes one serving of those yellow light foods per day. And if a woman is not on thyroid medication, then I would suggest two servings of those yellow light foods per day. There's a lot of examples of this. Yogurts, most types of yogurts, about 4 ounces. Also, most types of milk, about that much. Potatoes with skin, believe it or not, potatoes with skin have a moderate amount of iodine. Canned and salted navy beans will have that. Prune juice, pineapple juice. There's some odd things you wouldn't guess. Roasted sunflower seeds, an egg yolk. So there's a lot of options, and you'd want to include one or two of those a day during pregnancy. Two if you're not on medication. One is fine if you are, but it's less critical and harder to get none. So what about iodine supplements? Do you want to take an iodine supplement during pregnancy or iodine in a prenatal? Let's talk about first supplements of pure iodine. The most popular brand right now is called Iodorol. There are a few others as well. And the easy, easy answer is no. You do not want supplemental iodine during pregnancy. Tragically, there are many published cases of women who have had birth defects because they've done just that against medical advice. So iodine in prenatals, what about that one? Well, we look at the guidelines. We look at what the various medical associations are telling us. And most OBGYNs don't recommend for that. The American College of Gynecology and Obstetrics does not recommend for that. The American Academy of Clinical Endocrinology recommends that only in places with endemic iodine deficiency, which is not the US. The American Thyroid Association has said that the idea of using iodine, including prenatals during pregnancy, is tenuous. There's really no good evidence for that. So those are what the policies are. There's a group called the Cochrane Review Group, and they're pretty well respected for looking at big topics and doing meta-analysis, meaning they'll work through all the published studies and weed out the common thread from the overall body of knowledge. And they did that on the exact topic of iodine during pregnancy. So looking at all current human studies in the modern world, they found that taking iodine-containing multivitamins during pregnancy doesn't do anything good and actually does quite a few things bad. They showed that women who do so are probably going to have more nausea and vomiting. They may have higher levels of thyroid antibodies. Let's pause on that. There was a recent paper showing that pregnant women that have positive thyroid antibodies have a higher rate of the children developing autism. It's a harmful thing for the babies. It's not just, it's bad for mom, but it's bad for everyone. And that's been shown to be triggered by iodine-containing prenatal vitamins. They've also shown that there's no change that it has on mom's rate of getting thyroid disease, no benefit for baby, no benefit for preterm babies as well, and no benefit for baby's risk of thyroid disease. So there's really nothing to recommend it, no guidelines that encourage it, and no benefits from doing it, and many signs of harm from doing it. So I quite simply recommend against that. To be precise, women who are pregnant, I do encourage them to use our thyroid daily, which can be taken by itself or in the daily reset bundle, which is the thyroid daily, the omega pure, and our calcium magnesium. These are all fine during pregnancy. They do cover the bases for safe natural folate and all other essential nutrients. So in summary, iodine during pregnancy, it's a big deal. Like many other things during pregnancy, you want to get it right. And we know that what we need to do then is not the same as what we do during other times. But the story here is similar to the iodine story in general, in that we need some, it's not the bad guy, but we don't need all that much. And those prone to thyroid disease can get too much rather easily. So if you're on thyroid medication and you're pregnant or about to be, consider having one source of yellow light foods in your diet most days. Also consider the daily reset bundle as a healthy, safe, thyroid-friendly prenatal option. If you're not on medication, all that stuff applies, but then think more about 2 servings of yellow light foods per day. I mentioned a couple of big ones. There's way more in the thyroid reset diet, and you can also look at thyroidresetdiet.com/resources for a free list of those foods. All right, Dr. C with you. Take great care. We'll talk again really soon. Bye-bye.